Ski jumping is one of the most instantly recognisable and dramatic Winter Olympic events. After all, who could forget the sight of athletes flinging themselves off the side of a mountain and flying through the air? But have you ever wondered about the physics of it? Are they really flying? And with improvements in training and technology, how far could they eventually go? To answer this question, we have to take a look at the history of ski jumping. Like most of the Nordic skiing disciplines, ski jumping was first invented in Norway in the 19th century. Why did they invent this sport? I guess when you live in Norway in the 1800s, flinging yourself off the side of a mountain seemed like a good idea. It made its Winter Olympic debut at the very first Winter Games in 1924 and has remained an Olympic discipline ever since. It's certainly come a long way in that time. The very first jump ever recorded was 9.5 metres. Today, the world record stands over 250 metres. That's the equivalent of 25 London buses or 2.7 football fields for our American viewers. So, how were humans able to make such a dramatic improvement in just a little over 100 years? For that, we have to look at the physics of it. After the First World War, Tulin Tams and Sigmund Ruud developed a new jumping style known as the Konsberger technique. This involved jumping with the upper body bent at the hips and with arms extended at the front with the skis parallel to each other. Using this technique, Sepp Radl of Austria became the first person to jump more than 100 metres when he jumped 101 metres in 1936. In the mid-1950s, Swiss jumper Andreas Descher became the first jumper to hold arms backwards, close to the body, with a more extreme forward lean. Then, in 1985, Swedish jumper Jan Bolkvev started spreading the tips of his skis into a V shape. Initially ridiculed, this technique proved so successful that by 1992, all Olympic medalists were using this style. So why is the V shape so crucial to jumping the big distances? Well, it's all about airlift. Scientific tests have shown that the V-style improves airlift by 28%, meaning the jumper can remain in the air for a longer period of time. But let's break it down even further. Computer simulations show that during the early flight phase, the lift is much higher when the skis are splayed in a V. And during the later stages of the jump, the V also produces a larger drag, helping the athlete to slow down mid-air. So, have we reached the peak of ski jumping distances, or is there more to come? Of course, athletes are always striving to go faster, higher, and stronger, but further big improvements to the current world record might be limited. That's because jumpers are not allowed to extend the length of their jumps by improvements in technology. In the past, baggier suits have been worn to gain extra flight, and ski jumpers even dieted excessively to make their suits as baggy as possible. But it was felt that this gave an unfair advantage to some athletes, so the authorities stepped in. Nowadays, suits must conform to the contours of athletes' bodies in an upright position between 1 and 3 centimetres of their skin for men or between 2 and 4 centimetres for women. So, a little bit tighter than I'd wear on an average Saturday night. I can't breathe. But the next frontier of ski jumping might be female. Women with their lighter body weight are basically built for ski jumping. Although they had to wait 90 years to get their own event at the Winter Olympics, they have already made significant leaps. Get it? Significant. Okay, towards closing the gender gap completely.
This is because, although the way men are built gives them an advantage in many other sports, their physiology becomes a disadvantage when it comes to trying to fly the furthest. When you're speeding down the ramp, the most important thing is to stay balanced, stay low. This gives women with their naturally lower centers of gravity an advantage. Additionally, female jumpers have a natural advantage once they hit the air. Their lighter body weight helps them maximize lift and therefore time in the air.
So, will we see women sailing past men in the near future? With more and more women participating in the sport at the highest levels, I wouldn't bet against it. So, there you have it. Do you want more sports info? We've got plenty more for you. Make sure you subscribe to our channel now. Go on. I'm watching you.